Good afternoon to everybody on Mother's Day, and especially the mothers out there. AFL footballers wouldn't be anywhere without their mothers, and it's a big, big show. Steel Sidebottom, he is a Collingwood superstar. They nearly got over the line. He kicked three yesterday, and a man who made his return, Jack Redpath, over in the West. He was very, very good the other night too. As a workaround, we did have a big guest. We had David Zaharakis lined up, but he's got a cop one in the throat last night, so he's going to have an operation on his larynx today, I'm led to believe. So he couldn't be here today, but we've always got Shifter Sheen.
Yeah, Brownie, pleasure to be with you, and we're going to talk about how AFL players can turn up from anywhere. And Mark O'Connor, of course, debuted last night from Kerry. But we're going to give you an insight into a boy from Darley River, 200k south of Darwin. His name is Adam Sambono, and he's going to be on AFL club's list when he's announced as a player in the Allies as soon as tomorrow. So we'll give you an insight, that young fella.
Well, I like the sound of a little bit of a Sambono on this man. He was before his time in the 80s. He used to wear the headband before it was cool. He used to have the tanning machine. He's a premiership player. He's not a premiership coach, which is sad for me because I would have been one if he was the coach. But Terry Wallace joins us.
Hello, Brownie. How are you going? Look, this is a pathway show, and there was a magnificent pathway last night where James Kelly finally got to his 300th game. We're going to just go through his pathway and how he got to Geelong originally, because it's an amazing story.
It's an amazing story, and we'll get into it later, but it involves so many different clubs, so many different players, so many different picks. So stick around for that. James Stewart last night for the Bombers. He played his first game for the Bombers, 3 goals in the first half, and why wasn't he playing for the Pies?
It's just very unusual, isn't it? And you see his father, Craig, just giving him his jumper, which was a nice touch, an unusual touch, seeing that he played with other clubs. But look, this guy, young athletic player, Shifter, look, I thought at the time, and you think about what Collingwood now need is those athletic forwards. Whether he makes it, whether he doesn't make it, it was a great debut last night, but gee, I thought that the Magpies missed one there.
Yeah, he's certainly very underdeveloped at 18 years of age, and to see with Joey Danaher up there, they'd actually come through the National Academy together. At times we got them mixed up because they look quite similar as they moved forward for the ball. So he might be just that late mature, and that's a great bonus for the Bombers.
You know what was impressive about Stewart last night? He didn't get in Danaher's way, so they coexisted well. So you see a lot of forwards going up for the same footy. James Stewart was up, then he was back in the goal square, then Joe Danaher would go up. So he played his role really well.
Yeah, he did. And I think Shifter, you know, they had actually played together previously. So, I mean, at least they've got a little bit of synergy there. I actually saw a young man, Shifter, that you really like his pathway down in Tasmania yesterday, and that was Ryan Burton.
Yeah, it's amazing how they end up as players. This boy was a star at underage levels of forward. In fact, in his 17th year, he kicked 5 goals for SA. He looked to be a top 5 draft choice, then broke the leg. That can happen. And then he comes back at the, to draft combine, barely right, not even 100%. So Hawthorn took the punt, they took him in the late teens, and he's become the kicker behind the ball. He's a magnificent kicker. He sets the play up. You don't like to call it the quarterback role, but he just distributes it.
That's
so
what it
well.
Is, though, isn't it, yeah, these days? You can't play AFL footy these days unless you can set up from the back end and you're a very good kick. And he is an elite kick. His old man played for the Sandford, obviously. And one other player, we had him on the show a couple of weeks ago. Clary, his name is Clayton Oliver. The first 21 games of his career have been elite, haven't they?
Well, he's starring, and he was just everything that you want him to be again last night. In a, you know, magnificent, I think, that one of the greatest wins for the Melbourne Football Club for a long, long time. He is just a player who hunts the ball, and that goal was just unbelievable to be able to pluck it out there, extract the ball, and then be able to kick it from that angle was amazing. But look, it's his work at the stoppage, at ground level. He's a real bull.
Plough, how do you reckon you were going after your first 4 games of playing football ever?
I reckon I would have been really badly.
Well, the man last night played his first game after playing 4 games. They come from far and wide to play our game. And for Tobin Brothers, Multicultural Player of the Year. Over the years, Tobin Brothers developed experience, expertise in funeral customs of faiths and cultures, and serves a broad spectrum of our multicultural community. Shifter, what about this story?
Yeah, Mark O'Connor. Well, he's a product of the Ty Canelli runs a combine over in Dublin every year to raise awareness of opportunities in our game. And about September last year, he come out. Tiger brought him out. I actually chaperoned him for a couple of weeks as 4 clubs tried him out, including Geelong, Melbourne, Carlton and North Melbourne. He loved Geelong, so in the finish he chose Geelong over Melbourne, were probably second choice. They pitched really hard. He's just such an elite athlete, and one that really adapted very quickly to the Sheridan. He hadn't even seen the Sheridan until that stage, but some of his work on right and left over that 2 week period was so impressive that he had contract offers before he got back on the plane.
And good to see you're claiming in, Shifter. It's all about you bringing that young man. But a man that stood up yesterday, I was at this game, Jack Billings. There's a lot being written about him, the draft pick he was, but yesterday I felt this was a breakout game for him. 30 disposals, 5 goals. He really served up the Carlton. We had Jack Carlow on the show last week, who said his pre-season compared to last year was elite.
Yeah, and Brownie, I mean, he was the starter in that game as well. I mean, he got them up and going right from the outset. Was a magnificent player. I saw a lot of his junior football, and he was a gun. I mean, he was wider frame than some of the other players coming through. When we have a look at the top five shifter, we keep comparing, and it's because Bonampelli is fourth. Jack Billings is going to be a star. I have no doubt about that.
Well, without a doubt. I saw him yesterday, and he was clearly the best man on the ground. He's clean, he's one take, he kicks goals. And what I like about him, he starts the game early, he gets on with the game early, touches early, which is really important.
Oh, look, that's
a brilliant group, isn't it, Joe? How do you measure success at the end of their careers? At 200 games, 250? Bontempelli might end up the champion that wins everything out of that group, but I think they're all going to be terrific players, that top five.
And Shifter, there's a new name emerging in a riser for the draft. Young Tom North from the Eastern Rangers is really doing nice things at the moment and pushing himself up the order.
Yeah, Brownie, it's amazing how things can change pretty quickly. This boy, again, broke an ankle last year after starring in the first few games of the TAC Cup as a bottom age player. He didn't get back until the start of this year. Then yesterday, he's starting to get the spread you need as a left-footed inside. Well, he was an inside midfielder, but then showed that yard yesterday needed to spread. He kicked 3 goals. He dominated again. And he's a boy, young Tom North, that's now starting to show his genuine AFL potential.
Tasmania doesn't have an AFL team. It comes up every year. Normally, it's Tim Lane pushing the wheelbarrow of Tasmania to play AFL. But Nick Riewoldt wrote an interesting article saying that he thought that they should have an AFL team. And obviously, Nick, he's got his abalone licence down there in Tasmania. He just wants to get down there and do some abalone fishing, Terry.
Well, it'd be truly national if they did have a team. But, I mean, there still is a struggle. I was down there yesterday. You know, where would you domicile it if it was there? Is it Hobart? Do you play half the games in Hobart, half in Launceston? Does it have to be one or the other? So there's still some issues around it. But North Melbourne are doing some really good work down in Hobart now, Shifter.
They certainly are. They've got their next generation academy that has worked in with the Mariners program, their underage program there for the best young youth. And there's a couple of very good young players. We've mentioned them a couple of times on the show. One called Chase Jones, who's arguably, well, their second best to Tarryn Thomas. They're their two great boys. And young Jones unfortunately hurt an ankle yesterday, broke an ankle, dislocated as well, and he's having an op this morning. So we wish him all the best. He's a young star. He'll overcome
this
that.
This is young Thomas here.
And this is young Thomas.
North Launceston.
Well, he won their under 16 best and fairest and under 18 in the 1 year. No other kid's ever done that. He's a dominant player across halfback, an Indigenous boy from Launceston, and we look forward to seeing him emerge. He was back playing again yesterday.
Yeah, fantastic stuff. I like the push for the Tasmanian team. I think every time there's a game down there, it's a good game. There's a lot of support down there, and I think it'll be a great thing.
Yeah, look, if they can get it sorted out, I mean, that's the only thing, as I sort of said from the outset, I mean, it would really make it a national competition. Brownie, another thing that I'm always keeping an eye on is the father and son combinations that are coming through the competition. I think that it's a great part of the game, and we have another Brown on our midst Shifter, and this time it's Tyler Brown.
And Gavin Brown's boy. Of course, we had Callum last year. Tyler's a different type. It's more like Gavin, I think, as a young boy. I remember Gavin at Marsland College, very thin, and took a while to physically develop. And this boy, he's at Marsland as well. Just played about 3 or 4 TAC Cup games, but was impressive yesterday on the wing. Loved his speed. He's used for the ball as well.
And Patrick Naish, who's Chris Naish, has kicked 7 goals on Friday. His name keeps bobbing up. Every time I hear about the good players in the under-18s at the moment, this young man, his name's mentioned more often than not.
Yeah, from everything that I know about him, he's an absolute natural footballer, and 7 goals he kicked in school footy for Ivanhoe on Friday, as you mentioned. So he's going to be one that is going to be really in the limelight when we come towards the draft.
Been playing very well for the Northern Knights. You see him there playing for the Knights. He'll play for Vic Metro during the year, and that'll decide probably his draft position.
Sometimes there's a heavy name attached to a surname, and when you've got the surname of Ablett or Danaher or something like that, what about this young man, Nick Dacos? He's flying here. It's absolute royalty. He's a little man on the left there. So you've got obviously Tony Shaw, Peter McKenna in there. And there is Dacos there. It's absolutely fantastic.
In a Blues jumper.
Yeah. What's happened there?
Yeah, we'll have to sort of sort out that. But we're looking at them early these days, aren't we, Shifter? I mean, he's only a young man at 13 years of age still.
Kicked a few last week.
Oh, kicked about 10, did he?
12.
He's just 12. Wow, gee. We'll just have to watch for him in about 3 or 4 years' time. Let's hope he's really loving his footy at the moment.
We've got some overlay of Dacos here kicking those 12 goals last week. And Josh Dacos, sorry, 12 goals in a game of footy, player. That's just unbelievable.
Yeah, I kicked 13 once myself, Brownie, but that's okay.
end.
No, you didn't. No, you didn't. Gary Barracanara kicked seven on you in a state game once and you had 40 possessions and you were trying to tell me to man up. Very, very good. I've worked my way over to the McCafe and this man here, he is an elite of the elite. He is silky smooth whenever he gets the ball. His name's Steel Sidebottom. Welcome to Future Stars, mate.
Thanks for having me, Brownie.
It was a great game of footy yesterday. Just at the end, you felt that they were going to keep coming, keep coming, keep coming. Have a look at this last bit. I didn't think Maynard did much wrong here. He's right on Stevie J. He's got him arm across here, makes contact with him, but that's just as good a front and centre as you'll get.
Yeah, I don't think there's probably too much that Brothers could have done there. It was, you know, one of those ones that it's either hit or miss and probably one in 100 and he got that one last night, so disappointing.
Hard to put a finger on your form at the moment. I mean, one week you're brilliant, the next week you drop down and then to play away to GWS and be ahead of them by the best part of four goals and then to give up that lead. I saw Nathan Buckley in the coach's box after the game. He just looked like a lost man and it must be frustrating for the players as well.
Yeah, it is frustrating and as you said, we've played some good footy but then at other times we've let ourselves down. So consistency is the key for us and we just haven't been able to put games together this year. But, you know, we've showed signs of being able to play some good footy but there's still plenty of work to do.
Hey, there's no highlight reel like a great goal. Joe Danaher took a big mark last night, but have a look at this goal. You talk me through this.
Well, I think I might have been on heater at the time and I thought Brody was going to mark it, but he dropped it and, yeah, got me chance and just dribbled it through nicely.
You are an elite goal-kicking midfielder. I mean, we don't have many of them. Heath Shaw obviously giving you a bit of a ski rope to be able to do that with. But, I mean, you kicked 10 goals in a TAC Cup Grand Final, so that's a big effort.
Yeah, I don't mind. Like, I think all good footballers love getting around the goals and getting their fair share of goals. So if I see them, usually I'll have a shot.
Mother's Day today. Now, back in 2010, you were named the best name of all time. Worldwide. So they did this search and they thought Steel Sidebottom was the best name of all time. And clearly, your mum would have had to name you Steel, knowing that Sidebottom came after that. So it's a big happy Mother's Day back in 2010 for your mum.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, as you mentioned, I think the Collingwood Army got behind me and voted me in to win it that year. But, yeah, the name Steel comes, well, being one of five boys, mum wanted to call me a strong name and Steel is what I ended up with.
What did you win for that?
Nothing.
Just a notoriety. Well done, Steel. Good on you. Hey, growing up with four brothers, obviously very hard on your mum. So you've got five boys. I've got three girls myself and I see the toll it takes. But to have five boys in a house, I mean, you must have eaten a truckload.
Yes, there's no doubt we would have ate a lot and mum would have spent a lot of time in the kitchen. But, yeah, love growing up with four older brothers and some, you know, that I always looked up to growing up.
Now, another thing, doing research on you before the show, you love knowing what players' boots they wear. You know what certain players wear on their footwear, don't you?
Yeah, I do, most of them, yeah.
I'm going to throw a couple at you. What does Marcus Bontempelli wear?
Bontempelli wears Nike.
What does Nick Riewoldt wear?
Nike.
Pendlebury?
Puma now.
I'm going to give you a hard one. Heath Shaw.
Heath Shaw wears Puma now as well. Wore Diradora for a long time, but now he's gone to Puma.
That's extraordinary sort of stuff. That's like Rain Man sort of stuff, isn't it?
It is a little bit, but I was speaking just on the way in that, I don't know, I look at somebody and just look at their feet for some weird reason, but yeah, I just seem to remember what boots people wear.
Now, we've got plenty more to talk to Steele about. That's fascinating stuff. We're going to take him over to this. And if you want to ask him any questions or you want to ask Jack Redpath a question on Twitter, on Future Stars TV, there's the issues down the bottom, Facebook. If you want to get in control, ask a question. We'll get that answered for you. Stick around, plenty to come for INC Sports Nutrition on Future Stars after the break. Welcome back to Future Stars for INC Sports Nutrition. Big, big show. We've got Steel Sidebottom from the Pies in with us, mate. There was such a big news during the week. Scotty Pendlebury might not play, might have to leave at halftime. He was going to have the baby with Alex. Did anything go down yesterday? And what was the talk in the change rooms beforehand?
I suppose a lot was talked about, but obviously there was a bit in the media going on, but I think Pendles might have mentioned it.
Is this a bit of theatre here?
There is definitely. I think that's right after halftime too, so he's had plenty of time to go to the toilet, I think. But yeah, a little bit of theatre, I think, from Pendles.
It was actually absolutely hilarious. I mean, the drama surrounding it, and then all of a sudden we find he's just relieved himself. Well, that was the whole story. It was remarkable.
So you reckon he meant to do the whole theatre thing, go off and go to the toilet?
Yeah, a little bit of look Look at me, I think. Yeah, definitely.
Hey, Brody Grundy, what a player he's been. Aggressive. I thought he got beaten badly by Cruiser last week, but coming up yesterday, I thought he was really good.
Yeah, he is, and I think, you know, from this pre-season, for Brody, he's had he's been outstanding, and you know, he takes a lot of pride in his performance, and as you mentioned, he doesn't like getting beaten, so you know, might have lowered his colours a little bit last week, but really bounced back yesterday.
We'll have a look at a couple of other players in a second, but just last night's game, I mean, how frustrating to, you know, put in such a great performance up there, a side that had never beaten you, and it gets down to virtually almost the last kick.
Yeah, it's very disappointing. You know, we started off the game really well and probably let ourselves down, I think, in the second and third quarters. And then it was just sort of, you know, ebbs and flows of the game. They would kick one, we did. But, you know, that last 30 seconds for Stevie J to kick that goal is disappointing. But I don't think that's, you know, the reason why we lost. It was probably the middle parts of the game where we let ourselves down.
Just having a look at some of the vision as we're sort of speaking about it, it was just such an even game that really could have gone anyway. Just want to ask you about your own leadership. I mean, you've sort of grown as a player over the years and, you know, now a leader of your footy club.
Yeah, it's been awesome ever since I've been a part of it. When I first got voted in, I wasn't real keen on going in it, but, you know, ever since that I've put myself, well, been voted, but then agreed to go in it. Not only has it helped my footy, but just the way that I've been, you know, away from the club and the way I hold myself as well, so it's been good.
And still, just want to ask you about Will Hoskin-Elliott, one that a player that's now getting opportunity with you guys. He's added something, hasn't he?
Yeah, definitely. And, you know, I probably hadn't seen a whole lot of him at GWS. Wasn't playing consistent footy there, but he's just, yeah, he's great to watch when he gets the footy. He's very smooth. He's got elite skills. And
what boots he wear?
He wears Puma, man.
Just another one. I mean, obviously Jordan DeGoey had the issue earlier on in the year, but tell us about him as the player.
Geordie's, well, for us, yeah, another one of those big-bodied midfielders who will push forward as well. And as you mentioned, yeah, he played, you know, the last kind of 3 weeks before last in the VFL and probably looked a class above, I think, so to get Geordie back in there, you know, around the footy and, you know, playing to his strength. He played well yesterday and, as you mentioned, he's a young player, so he's just going to keep getting better as games go on.
He's not the first player to ever be sent back or mess up or anything. What was his demeanour like? And, I mean, could other young players learn from it?
Yeah, he definitely. He went back and did everything that was asked from him and probably more as well. He hung around the club for, you know, he's probably first there and last to leave, so you know, he took it on the chin. He's obviously young, as you said, but he'll definitely learn from it.
Now, Stu, we want to wind back the clock. It's only 10 years now to think that that you were the young kid at Etihad Stadium that had this unbelievable grand final. What do you recall of this? Phil Bunn was your coach. He's now the recruiting guy at the Adelaide Crows, of course. What do you recall of this game?
Obviously, I remember it quite well. It was one of those days where, you know, the ball bounces your way and, yeah, you just obviously wanted to put yourself around the footy because, yeah, it was just coming to me and things were coming off, but it was obviously a special day.
Well, it was 32 possessions and 10 goals, of course, but right and left, like, where did that come from, the right and left foot ability? Is it playing with the brothers in the backyard? Is someone really focused on that in your upbringing? Because that was absolutely outstanding.
Probably is that. As I mentioned earlier, being the youngest of five boys, we're always kicking the footy out the back, probably out the front and inside. So I've always kicked the footy and, yeah, probably just use both sides.
32 and 10. Imagine the ranking points you would have got for that as a super coach. I'll tell you what, the hair was a bit thicker back then too.
It's thinning out and don't worry, I'll get told about it a bit.
Speaking of thinning out, Terry Wallace is over at the Plasma.
Thank you very much, Brownie. Look, today we're having a look at a draft pick that ended up travelling all across Australia to finish up nabbing a star, and that star was James Kelly, who played his 300th game last night. It was pick number 17 back in 2001, and it started with the Richmond Football Club, who decided to on-trade that pick to Sydney for Nick Daffy, and pick 17 went to Sydney, and Greg Stafford turned up at the Richmond Footy Club. Sydney then got hold of that and parcelled up some selections, which included 13 and 45, to nab Barry Hall, which I think was a pretty fair pick-up, no doubt, with Barry Hall becoming a captain of their premiership side. So all of a sudden, now the pick was in the hands of the St Kilda Football Club. They wanted Heath Black, who was in the same year as what you were in the national draft, Brownie. And all of a sudden they wanted him back from Fremantle. So pick number 17, who had travelled from Richmond, gone to Sydney, gone to St Kilda, was now all of a sudden at the Fremantle Dockers. Well, Fremantle then were in a position where they wanted Jeff Farmer to come back home to WA. And so all of a sudden the 17 was going back across the Nullarbor once again and going to the Melbourne Football Club. Melbourne saw something that they liked in Clint Bizzle. They gave away that number 17, I should say, and pick 41 to get Bizzle to the Melbourne Football Club. And all of a sudden, 17 was going down the highway down to Geelong. It stopped there. Six teams had the opportunity of actually having a pick in the national draft. Geelong decided, no, we're going to use a pick. And they started to have a look at a young man by the name of James Kelly. Now, Shifter, you were around doing things still back in those days. Tell us about what they would have been looking at and what the other clubs missed.
This is what they saw. You see him in the navy blue jumper playing for Vic Metro, the number four there in the centre of the ground, strong overhead, contested ball winner. I had the pleasure of watching this game again on Friday, just going over it. This was a super game to watch. Kelly was a star in it, but Gary Ablett, Campbell Brown, Jimmy Bartel, they're all in the game. It was unbelievable. Lee Montagna was in the game. Stevie J. There was 15 AFL players in the game here, and this is of course the super draft, and these boys have still survived. Jared Waite, another one of those in that particular game, and they've been wonderful players for us. The older one of course is Sam Mitchell. He was already about 20 years of age and had played for Vic Metro a couple of years earlier, but it still remains the super draft, the best of all time.
We've got some overlay of Stevie J and Joe Montagna playing in those championships as well here, so there's Stevie J coming
front and square again.
He doesn't look any lighter than what he does there. He's about the same, isn't he, Stevie J?
Just so creative. He kicks this goal here, but he set up many others. He's a boy of 188 from the Murray Bush Rangers, of course, that really set the championships apart, was an All-Australia at this level. This is Lee Montagna.
Come off in the draft, didn't
he? Yeah, 37, I think he went. He came off the bench in this game and starred. His foot speed, his electrifying pace was so prominent in this game and had a big influence on Vic Metro winning the championship.
So that's the James Kelly story. It's remarkable how it works. It only would have needed one of those trades to have some sort of problem with it, and all of a sudden you don't know where James Kelly finishes.
But it seemed like every club who got somebody out of it too. Like Barry Hall, Jeff Farmer was good, Clint Bizzle was handy for Geelong as well. So fascinating stuff. Well done, Plout. Now, Steel Sidebottom, thanks very much for joining us, mate. You're a superstar. We'd love to have you back soon. Good luck to the Pies for the rest of the year.
Nice, thank you.
Steel Sidebottom from the Collingwood Football Club. Up next, Big Jack Redpath. He got the first game of the year after a knee reco, and he was very, very good the other night. He's over at the McCafe. So try McCafe's finest ever barista-made coffee at drive-thru or McCaffrey's drive-thru. It's going to be fantastic. We'll speak to him next for INC Sports Nutrition. You are watching Future Stars. Welcome back to Future Stars for INC Sports Nutrition. What a story Jack Redpath is. He's done three knee recos in his career. He was picked 26 in the rookie draft back in 2011. He was back in the team the other night. He kicked three goals. He joins us. Welcome, mate. It's a long path from where you're from in Kyneton to get to where you were the other night.
It has. Obviously, you know, you have the two injuries early, playing some VFL and stuff, and then to get an opportunity and have a couple early days at the Bulldogs. I broke my arm my first year, but then last year was a bit disappointing. But I come back and I'm back quicker than I thought. And you know, if you had told me last year that I would have played round eight, I would have taken that. So I'm pretty happy.
No, that kick the first goal, kick three was very good. Your form, to get to this part of your career, you were a builder, you were in Kyneton, then you went down and played a little bit of footy for Williamstown. It is pretty much what this show is about. It is about the future stars who either come through the draft like the normal way or somebody who just busts the door down like you have.
Yeah, I suppose. Obviously, I was a carpenter. I left school a little bit early. I did my apprenticeship. I worked for 6 years. So I kind of had that, and you know, all along I loved playing footy with my mates and stuff like that. And then you know, having the injuries, some people ask, you know, is, you know, you push through that and, you know, how did you keep going? But in the end, it probably made me want it a little bit more, you know, because you do an injury and you realise, you know, how much you miss the game. And so every time I've hurt myself, I've sort of has probably made me want to play, you know, better and get better as I go. So
we just saw a vision of the players getting around you. I mean, everyone knows, yeah, you've had Clay Smith at the footy club. You've had a lot of guys that have had nasty injuries, obviously Mitch Wallace. But yeah, you see the guys have got a real empathy for somebody sort of coming back. How special was that moment, you know, with the boys getting around you?
Yeah, it was. I was pretty nervous. As the ball was coming in, I think I was already thinking about the goal. As Bailey kicked it, I was already thinking about the goal. So, but yeah, I think, you know, you guys know what it's like at a football club. You do a knee and it's a long way back. The rehab, it's long. You know, the first 6 months is also, I've always thought it's probably the easiest part. And then, you know, that the following, you know, 3 months is really, really hard work because you have little setbacks with your body and, you know, all the boys see you, you know, working so hard in the gym, and then to kick that goal, you know, everyone sort of, you know, gets around you and it's a good feeling.
Jack, we just want to pick up on that journey again, and I read that, well, at 21, you had your 21st birthday, then 2 days later, you were picked in that rookie draft, and I think your mum shed a tear. But you'd done two ACLs already at that stage. Did you ever think that that AFL dream just wouldn't happen for you? And how come you're so resilient? You know, that's amazing that you could hang in there.
Yeah, I suppose, yeah, that day, it was, you know, it was a great day. I'd worked in the morning, I'd come home and jumped on the computer and obviously watched the rookie draft, but I trained with the Dogs on the Friday. 21st was the Saturday, and had all the boys around, and I think I ended up going to bed about 11 o'clock and they went right through to the morning. So, yeah, but then I got to train again on the Monday and did some speed testing and, yeah, obviously, you know, got my opportunity, and, you know, I sort of couldn't believe it for the first year, kind of, you know. I was playing VFL at Williamstown and playing Williamstown in the reserves there, and at stages I probably thought, how did I get here and stuff like that, but, yeah, I think as I grew and, you know, got hold of, you know, my body and started to understand that, I started to play some good footy.
So your advice for boys that have setbacks, we'll see you playing here at Williamstown and the vision here, and there are many boys out there that have setbacks along the way, you know, what's the advice to those that do have the little setback?
I think the biggest thing for me that I learnt was just put in the work that, you know, the rehab coaches give you, and, you know, I had good physios even when I was at Bendigo, and I probably learnt from that first knee that, you know, I probably just needed to do a little bit more strength work and get the confidence back. And, you know, credit goes to the Bulldogs medical staff, you know, Nick Stone and Chris Bell and Shane O'Sullivan, all the guys there have worked so hard to get me back and in the position where I can play some good footy.
I can remember you, I saw you playing down at Kyneton when you were a teenager. Nathan Thompson was down there at the time, and I went to one of the games. Who were some of the people, whether they're mentors, whether they're just close friends, that have sort of, you know, been part of the journey? Because it's been an up and down journey for you. Who sort of helped you along the way?
Yeah, it's kind of, probably number one was probably Mum all along. Massive supporter, obviously, of mine.
What's your mum's name? Say happy Mother's
Samantha,
Day.
Samantha. Happy birthday. Happy Mother's Day, Mum. But yeah, you know, Mum was always pretty carefree and just let me, you know, she never forced anything on me or anything like that. But, and then it sort of just went through probably older brothers. I had two really good bosses, you know, that I did my carpentry with. The second one, Neville Messina. I did my apprenticeship with Nev, and he was probably the one that more pushed me towards the VFL kind of thing, because, you know, he knew some people up there, and, you know, and then it was probably Nathan Thompson in the end, who, I remember we had a conversation one day after my second knee, and he just said, you know, give it another shot, you know, you got nothing to lose, you love playing the game, so, yeah, I'm pretty happy I did.
What about the building? Any chance to go back to the building when you finish your career? What sort of builder were you? Chippy, obviously.
Yeah, yeah, we just did, you know, new home extensions, renovations, all that sort of stuff. So, you know, I thought I was okay at it. You know, there's still a long way to go. It's kind of like, it's kind of like an AFL career, really. You sort of, you know, you get in, you do your 2-3 year apprenticeship, and you know, and then you start to have some confidence in your body, and, you know, you feel you know, confident out there. But yeah, definitely after footy, that's exactly what I'll be doing.
Nice kicking goals at the main stadium, though, isn't it?
Oh yeah, it's a great job at the moment. So.
It's a great story, mate. We have the Chemist Warehouse gift lounge for you. It's one of the best prize packs in the business, and we've got some fragrances for your mum for Mother's Day, so she won't go home empty-handed. The real house of fragrance for this Mother's Day. Totally work with these King G Urban boots. If it doesn't work out this week, you can go back to Chippy next week. They're $240 a pair. You'll be able to build that many houses with them. It's that funny. Night for two at Melbourne's Parkview Hotel in St Kilda Road, close to everything. Think that is Melbourne. I'd give that to your mum as a Mother's Day gift. Thanks to Mac as a $50 gift voucher. Head in to taste their finest barista-made coffee ever. Sam & Co, 447 Chapel Street. Some of the best suits you'll get down there. Best clothes, shirts, shoes. To see all the Hawthorn boys get down there. And round for four, Carthage Club Mandalay, clubmandalay.com.au. The Steel gift voucher. Thanks to our mates at Steel and their awesome new battery-powered garden tools. Grab a delicious meal. $100 voucher at Platform 28 right across the road here at Docklands. If you come to a game at the Docklands. And HD sports action camera, thanks to Telstra in Thomastown, 69 Dalton Road, and this fantastic Dometic cool icebox, Dometic mobile living made easy. That is the best prize pack in the business, thanks to Chemist Warehouse. Big game down at the Cattery this week.
Yeah, it is. It's going to be, it's a big task going down there, but I think we're due to play some, all four quarters, so. On the weekend probably wasn't the result we were looking for, and again we didn't play the way we wanted to for the whole game, so we'll be looking for a four quarter effort this week.
Good luck for the rest of the year, mate. Jack Redpath from the Western Bulldogs on their fight to go back to back this year. Plenty still to come on Future Stars for INC Sports Nutrition. Happy Mother's Day to all the mothers out there. If you haven't got a gift, get down to the Chemist Warehouse. They'll have everything you need for your Mother's Day. You're watching Future Stars for INC Sports Nutrition. Time now to have a look at the TAC Cup results for round number 8. Geelong Falcons, they just keep on going, as do the Murray Bush Rangers. Big win there. Calder Cannons beat Gippsland. Eastern Rangers defeated my boys, Bendigo Pioneers, by 5 goals. The Rebels take on the Jets, which will be kicking off soon, and the Dandenong Stingrays take on the Oakley Chargers. Now it's time for the INC Elite Performer of the Week. Shift over to you.
This is Mitch Podolsky, is the guy that wins it. He's kicked 6 goals yesterday, and in a role where he's the swing man. He played half the game at centre-half back, half in the forward line, kicked 6 after playing back all
good
year.
Good versatility.
Well, and he's emerging as a Vic Metro prospect now to play national championships. The boy won 90 centimetres from Aberfeldy, a great producer of talent, and he had a terrific day yesterday with that best on the ground performance.
Oh, it's a great asset to be able to have, to be able to go both Isn't ends it? Of the ground. Enormous. I mean, we've seen so many good swingmen. I had to go to Ben Reid last night playing down forward for the Magpies.
Hunter at the West Coast Eagles played in a premiership. If you're a recruiting manager, just go tick.
Yeah, look, we've got a couple of other boys that we want to have a look at, Shifter, and one of those is young Noah Bolter.
Yeah, a teammate too at the Calder Cannons. He's a boy that, he's mixed it between back and forward, a little bit in the ruck, and he's raw in the game. So we use the term, he's got plenty of upside. Still plenty to learn, but he is super athletic. Was added to the National Academy under Luke Power, and, Luke threw him into defence for the first time to get that experience. Enormous leap he's got, natural athlete. You've got to learn that positioning, where to run, what to do, but at 195 centimetres, there's a lot to like about him.
Well, Brownie, there's another star on the rise. You know, I love my basketball background players. Young man who had a basketball background with the AIS, Jack Petricelli from the Northern Knights. Have a look at the speed of this guy.
He's quick.
2.82 over 20 metres. He is a real star to keep an eye on.
And just new to the game too. Switched from an AIS scholarship into footy just late last year. Just had a handful of games. Now, fantastic yesterday. That blistering speed and that power you see with that leaper is X factor.
You do love your basketballs. And it'd be remiss of me to mention that I do it every year. But a player pulled into a service station many, many years ago. And there was a guy filling up the tank with petrol. He was about 226 centimetres. You were the coach of the Bulldogs at the time, and you thought, I'm going to take a chance on this kid. I'm going to walk over and ask him to come down to train. And he just couldn't quite get his head around the ball, could he?
No, I got probably 20 tanks of petrol out of it, so it was not all lost. But, when I saw him run the first time, it took him about half an hour to get around the oval. I knew we had problems.
But if you don't have a crack, you don't know. He could have turned out to be the biggest superstar of all time, unfortunately for you. He didn't. He couldn't play. Now, time for the Builders Academy Team of the Year. Builders Academy, visit builders.com.au, and this man is Brian Myers. He's going to go straight into the team, Shifter.
Yeah, kicked three again yesterday. We talked about him last week, competing to a Luke Dalhouse. So he plays at fifth, six roles. So pushes up the ground, averages 20 possessions, got that radar around the goals, that innate ability to kick them from all angles. So he's been a star for the Falcons this year, and they're right up on top of the ladder, of course.
Got a nice little sidestep out there when he as he shot a goal. So he goes straight into the team. He's into the forward pocket. He's a nice young man. Got some nice names in there. McCartan, the brother Rob, Werpel, we had on the show. Spargo, we've had on the show so far this year.
We've got some work to do on our back line here, Brownie. It seems like everyone wants to play centre forward.
That's the way it should be. We're going to head to a break on Future Stars. There's still plenty more to come, including Katie Brennan burning it up in the VFL. Stick around. Welcome back to Future Stars for INC Sports Nutrition. It's been a massive show so far. Jack Redpath, what a man. He's still side bottom. He just carves it up every time you see the Collingwood players. Now, home buyers coach, under 18 coach of the year, Jeremy Barnard from the Sandringham boys down there. He was the flag winner last year and he is our coach of the week.
Well, very deserving, because this is a coach that's done the journey. And I mean, that's what coaching's all about. Started at Strathmore, assistant coach at Sandringham for a period of time, finally gets the job himself, goes on and wins a premiership with some of those star boys last year, McGrath, Taranto, Setterfield playing in that particular side. But it's more than that. It's more the development of the whole group, and he's doing a fantastic job.
You love him, don't you?
No, he's
that was just like, get him into the AFL.
Well, I like the journey. I like guys who have actually had to earn the right to get that opportunity.
Well done. And he's got a couple of very good players under him at the moment. One of those is young Brayshaw.
Yeah, that's Hamish, who, it's unfortunate when you go to your draft combine in a wheelchair, and that's what happened with him last year. So it wasn't his time. He had a crook foot. He'd tried to play with that through the finals, but he's now come back as a 19-year-old in the TAC Cup. So it's Angus's brother, of course. Prolific
ball. Overage.
Overage, 19-year-olds, a great rule to allow free to be able to play each week in TAC and in national championships who are 19.
Some of the recent ones that have been drafted overage, Langdon English, Jamie Elliott's a good one. Jack Steele, isn't he playing some good footy at the moment? And probably the best of a lot of them down the bottom there is Mitch McGovern. And this Adam Sambono, you've been going on about this bloke for about 6 weeks now, Shifter. It feels like he's going to go number one in the draft.
Ah, no, but wonderful to see this boy emerge. We said he's from Daly River, where if you look it up, you Google it, you'll find it's a long way from anywhere. In the middle of nowhere in the Northern Territory, he hasn't played in these underage championships at any stage, but then emerged this year in the NTFL, and then he's playing in the Northeast AFL for Territory Thunder. He's 20 years of age. He's not 19 or 18, but he'll play in the under-18 championships for the Allies. The squad will be announced tomorrow. A left footer. We're going to look forward to watching how this prolific goal scorer goes in nationals.
Yeah, the women's VFL kicked off last week, so it's round two going ahead this week. Geelong, big winners over Seaford. Derebin over the Eastern Devils. And we've got a couple of games on today, Plough.
Yeah, and the person we want to concentrate on is Katie Brennan. We know that she got injured in the AFLW. She's a star of the game. Come back and play with Derebin. This was a game, I mean, Derebin were the almighty side that got beaten last week. The game was on the line at three-quarter time again. Could have gone either way, but the Derebin girls got up, and it was Katie Brennan kicked three goals in the game and was one of the major reasons why they got the result.
She's an absolute superstar, and we've got the best video production guys here at Future Stars that you can put together, and they've put together this one. We've got a fantastic insight into the wonderful work of BCNA at the Pink Lady match last week, supported by Red Energy. Have a look at this. Great stuff.
Like so many families across the country, we've been affected by breast cancer and feel that this is just a wonderful way to promote the cause of finding solutions.
I come along actually every year to get the awareness factor out for the Breast Cancer Network of Australia. I think it's really important to get around it and to raise a lot of funds for the organisation.
It's a real great cause. The more people get around it, the more the awareness goes up and more events you can do like this.
absolutely couldn't have been prouder. This is a tremendous event that we've held every year. We're really lucky today that we've got two fantastic teams in Melbourne and the Mighty Hawks that are out there battling it head-to-head. So their supporters have really got into the swing of things. Red Energy, our major partner of this match, have provided over 30,000 caps. There's a sea of pink out there, and we're really thrilled that the fans have got behind the work that we do.
Breast cancer is prolific. It's the diagnosis rate is almost 18,000 a year, which is a huge number. And you know, us doing our part in funding events such as today really drives the awareness.
Red Energy have been a fantastic partner in this game and other things that they do with us. They're very helpful. They're very honestly engaged, and we appreciate them very much as a partner. I can't believe how it's grown. It's fantastic. It's a great experience. We're lucky with a beautiful day today. There's a good crowd out there, and let's hope that everyone notices the pink and Melbourne wins.
It's always been big, the BCNA game. It was probably the first real involvement any AFL clubs had promoting women's causes, and it shows you what football can do to bring causes to the front and tell people, educate people about what's important in these things.
Welcome back to Future Stars, Brian C. Sports Nutrition. We asked at the top of the show Facebook questions, Twitter questions. We had one come in for you, Shifter. Are there any more Irish players to look out for? That's from Mark Brooks. Well done, Brooksy.
Well, there's a boy called Killian McDowd. He's from Galway that's been on Tadhg Kennelly's radar, so we'll bring him out later in the year. At least two will come out to join our national combine group in September.
Oh, nice place, Galway. The King's Head pub there, you've been there?
In Galway.
Very, very good night out there with the Australian team many, many years ago. It was a very good night. Let's get into more important things. Your book you've got right here, Country Round, Essendon Geelong last night.
And as part of that, there's a launch on Friday. Kevin Sheedy, Terry Danner and Danny Frawley, three great supporters of country footy. We're at this launch, book by Paul Daffy, Behind the Goals, the story of the Victorian Country Football League, 120 years of history and how the game of footy is ingrained in our culture in country Victoria.
Well, Brownie, last week we got our Rising Star nomination in Sam
yes.
Petreski's seat and
yes,
over the
did.
Line. A couple to have a look at this week for me. Tim Taranto, I think, is just about due. I like the way that he's playing
he's a ripper.
Footy.
And
he's Adam got Pim into it. It's very tough to get into one of the top sides in the competition and be able to hold your spot. He's just doing a really nice job. He makes the right decisions at the right time. So I would like to maybe see him get a nomination in the next week or so. The other one, Charlie Kerno. We're having a bit of a blues fest at the moment. But I like
well,
Charlie.
They're going with youth.
I like Charlie and I like the way he's developing. Midfield, forward, can play both roles.
Attacks the footy, doesn't he?
He's going to be an outstanding player for this club for a long, long time.
Where's the Blues list heading in the right direction?
Perfectly in the right direction for me.
Yeah, very nice, Charlie Kerno. And McGrath last night again. I know he's been nominated already, but he was terrific again last night.
Yeah, look, he plays like a senior player from the moment that he walked in the door. I mean, his first game, remember he was playing on Rioli and Bruce in his very first match.
It's been a big show today. Thank you to Shifter, thanks to Plough. We had Steel Sidebottom on the show. We also had Jack Redpath from the Bulldogs. Been a massive show. We'll be back next week with the biggest guests, the best prizes in the business. It's a beautiful day outside today, so may the sun shine on you and have a cracking Mother's Day to all the mothers out there. We love you all. Bye.